Good morning, students. Welcome to Grade 10 NCERT Economics Chapter 3, Money and Credit. Previously, we discussed in two chapters, Development and Sectors of Indian Economy. I hope that you understand these two chapters. Now, the third chapter we are going to discuss into 10 topics. So, first of 5 topics we are going to discuss first in the first video. History of money, money as a medium of exchange, barter system, and double coefficients of funds. Number 4, limitations of barter system. Number 5, deposits with banks. So in this today's video, first video, we are going to discuss history of money, money as a medium of exchange, barter system and the double coefficients of funds, limitations of barter system and deposits with banks. So first we take history of money. In this the word money is derived from the Latin word moneta, currency. So the word money is derived from the Latin word moneta and currency. The word money and currency, these two words, the word currency and money is derived. The modern currency of India is made of paper. The word money or currency is derived from the Latin word moneta or currency. The modern currency or money in India is made of paper currency or coins, metallic coins with the denomination of rupees. Paper currency rupees 1, 2, 5, 10, 20, 50 rupees, 100 rupees, 200, 500 and 2000. So these are the paper constantly are using frequently at present. Besides the paper currency, coins denomination from 50 paisa, rupees 1 rupee, 2 rupee coin, 5 rupee coin and 10 rupee coin. These are the metallic coins that we are using at present. But one thing you must understand that paper currency, these 1, rupees 1, rupees 2, rupees 5 are not frequently used at current days, at present days. But still it is in usage, it is not that demonetized. But frequently we are using 10 rupees, 20 rupees, 50 rupees, 100 rupees, 200 rupees, 500 rupees and recently we are have a denomination of 2000 rupees. So these are the paper currency that we are using in the present days and the coins also like that. 50 paisa and 10 rupee coin are not frequently used, but these two metallic coins also we are using at present day, but it is not frequently used. These coins and currencies are authorized and recognized by the Government of India. Paper currencies and coins are printed and minted by the Reserve Bank of India in the name of central government. Therefore, these coins and currencies are recognized and authorized by the Government of India. Similarly, all the countries in the world have their own coins and currencies and they are also recognized and authorized by the government of respective countries. Please try to understand, not only in India, all the countries have their own coins and currencies. These coins and currencies are also recognized or authorized by the respective countries. Thus, these coins and currencies are widely accepted and legally recognized as payment for goods and services. Thus, the coins and currencies are widely accepted and widely accepted and legally recognized as payment for goods and services. Now the currencies are printed in their countries, each and every countries, and these coins and currencies are recognized by the government of the country, and therefore it is accepted as widely accepted and legally recognized as payment for goods and services before the introduction or invention of money there were different objects such as grains, cattle, salt and seashells. These are also used as medium of exchange. So first we discussed from where the money, the word is derived, money and currency. And next we discussed how the money is accepted as a medium of exchange, because the government, every government in the world, they mint or print the coins and currencies and recognize it. Therefore it is used as a medium of exchange. Before the invention of paper currency or metallic coins, people used different objects like grains, cattle, salt and sugar. Seashells, these are also is used as money for transaction or medium of exchange. During the Sangam age, there are three Sangams existed in India in the ancient period, that is before the Christ of Jesus Christ. There were three Tamil Sangams, first Sangam, second Sangam and third Sangam. These are the Sangam were existed to develop Tamil literature and Tamil culture. Therefore this period is called Sangam age. During the Sangam age people used metallic coins made of gold, silver and copper. Please try to understand, around 600 BC, Sangam age, around 60 century BC. BC means before common era, that is before the birth of Jesus Christ, the Sangam age period, people used coins made of metallic coins made of gold, silver and copper. But after the Sangam age getting over or ended, there is no any coins and currencies were found. The total Sangam age period is getting over. After that, the government established in India, that is in North India, the Mauryas, this is also is before Common Era, Mauryas, Guptas in the after Common Era AD. So these Mauryas, Guptas and Satavahanas and Vijayanagara empires, these are all which comes in the AD. So this period also the rulers issued many coins made of metals, the same gold and silver and copper. And after this period, Mughal empires came to rule India. This Mughal empire also is introduced many coins. But Shershah-Suri period, Shershah-Suri, 1539 to 1545, introduced new coins and currencies. Therefore, he is called as father of modern currency. Please try to understand, there are so many periods, even before Jesus Christ period, coins were used in India, and later on these coins are not continued because the particular period is ruined. Therefore, later on the kings who ruled the country, they also issued many coins and currencies. And particularly Shershah-Suri, 1539 to 1545, he ruled from Delhi. So his period, he introduced new coins and currencies. These coins are considered as is new for India, and because he regulated the coins and currencies, therefore he is considered as the father of modern currency. However, British introduced paper currency. Question will come, who introduced paper currency in India? British, through the Act of Paper Currency Act 1861. However, the British introduced through the Act of Paper Currency Act of 1861. So in the year 1861, they introduced a new policy over the currency or coins for economic activity. This act is called Currency Act of 1861. This act gave monopoly power or power or rights to print currency in India. So from this what we understand, there are different periods, different coins and currencies were used. Before the invention of coins and currencies, different objects were used, such as salt, then seashells, grains, cattle, these are also used. Then in the year 1861, the British introduced paper currency. So from the Paper Currency Act gave the monopoly power, only the government to print and mint the coins and, currency and coins to really issue the paper currencies in India after independence. The RBA, that is Reserve Bank of India, RBA means Reserve Bank of India, printed print currency and mint coins in India. At present, only the RBA is the only organization which or institution which print the currencies and mint the coins for India. No individual or any other organization have right to print or mint any coins or currencies in India. Now we are going to have seen some of the countries' coins and currency. Their symbols, each country have some different symbols they use to denote their currencies or coins. That we will see now. Different countries use different symbols and different names for their currencies. Name of the currency. Name of the country. First we take India. India symbol is, this is India currency symbol, and India currency name is rupee. The word rupee is derived from the Sanskrit word rupya. Rupya is the Sanskrit term for rupee. Rupya means it is shaped, that is give the dimension, or it gives the stamped, the coins is stamped, therefore it is used the term rupiah. From the rupiah word, rupee is derived. It is used in India and their neighbors. Who are the independent of India? Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, Bhutan, then what's called that? Sri Lanka, these are the countries using their country's currency rupee. Pakistan rupee, Bangladesh rupee, then it is called taka, and there is also Nepal currency. Nepal currency is also used, same rupee, Sri Lanka rupee, so like that. the Indian India and neighboring countries use the word rupee. You may be heard dollar. It is across is used for dollar. Dollar is used in USA and Singapore. It is called USA dollar, Singapore dollar. This is a symbol of euro. European Union. And this is a symbol of Japan yen. Yen is a currency name of Japan, and the country is Japan. This is a symbol of yuan. This is a yuan. Yuan is a currency name of China. So these are the different names of their currencies and the symbols they use, and these are the countries they use these currencies. Now we are going to discuss the second topic in the lesson, money as a medium of exchange. Second topic is money as a medium of exchange. What is the way? Exchange. Exchange means a transacting, that is a giving and a getting. So therefore they use the term exchange. Here money plays an important role in an economy in the contemporary world. Money plays an important role in an economy in the contemporary world. Money acts as a medium of exchange. For goods and services. If a person have money, buy any goods and services with the use of money. Please try to understand. Money plays an important role in an economy, any economy in the contemporary world, and money acts as a medium of exchange for goods and services. For example, if a person have lump sum of amount in his hand, he can buy any goods and services with this money, So because money is being bought and sold in the market. Money is being goods and services. Goods and services are being bought and sold in the market. With the use of money, so what we understand, goods and services are being bought and sold with the use of money, because money solves the problem of double coincidence of wants . Money easily solves the problem of double coincidence of wants in the barter system. Money is sometimes pay advance with the promise of delivery of goods and services in the future. Money solves the problem of double coincidence of wants in the barter system. Earlier, the barter system was practiced in the country, in the world, and therefore money was introduced. So money easily solves the problem of double coincidence of wants, and also money is sometimes used as a pay advance with the promise of delivery of goods and services in the future. The modern currency is found in the form of paper currency, called metallic coins. These metallic coins is not silver or gold. These are made of ionic metal, nickel coated ionic metal. The modern currency. Is made of paper metallic coils, besides these, there are plastic currencies, that is credit cards and debit cards. So in the recent years, not only that the paper currency or metallic coins, there are other form of currencies that is called paper currencies, that is credit cards and debit cards and e-banking. E-banking through mobile phone. Through mobile phones and POS. That is the point of sales. Swipe machine. The credit cards, credit card, besides these credit cards, even there is one more opportunity that people can exchange or transact their goods and services through the e-banking, through the mobile phone, and also there is a point of POS, is a point of sales swipe machine. So in this also people can transact without using of money. Apart from that, there is a checks demand draft, that is DD. DD and MO, money order. Money orders. These are other form of exchange. Cashless transaction. Cashless transactions means they do not use currency or coins. They use the latest method, latest machines or devices like POS or mobile phone. And apart from that, there is a sheet of paper checks, money orders or demand draft is a piece of, it is a sheet of paper which is mentioned the date and account holder number, account holder name and his account number and check number. So everything is given in the detail in the what is called the checks. It is mentioned to whom the money is or the check is made. So these are the way that transaction is made possible in the recent years. Thus modern currency made our economic activity more simple and easier and quicker. Thus, modern currency and devices made our transaction. Simple and quick. So now, so far we discussed that how money is used as a medium of transaction. Next, we are going to discuss the topic, third topic, barter system and double coincidence of funds. What is the barter system? Third topic, barter system. And double coincidence of funds. What is barter system? A barter system was practiced in the ancient period modern currencies. Replace system. In this system, in the barter system, goods and services were exchanged directly. Goods to goods or services without use of money. Try to understand what the question will come. What is barter system? Barter system is nothing but it was practiced in the ancient period and modern currencies replaced this system. The barter system in the barter system, goods and services were exchanged, that is transacted or exchanged directly one goods to another goods. So therefore it is written goods to goods or also service. If they are instead of goods, the people do some services, some work for the people, so they will give goods for them. So it is goods to goods or goods to service without use of money. So this system is called barter system. Double coincidence of funds is the feature of this system. It is a major condition. It is a compulsory. Both buyer and seller or exchangers of goods and services must to accept the goods and services, otherwise they cannot exchange any trade or business. Double coincidence of funds. Is the most important teacher of this system. For instance, for example, we take two persons in the market. One is a shoemaker. The shoemaker wants to sell his shoes for, he wants to exchange his shoes for wheat. He wants some wheat for his home. So he wants to sell his shoes for wheat. He came with his product. At the same time, the wheat producer also accept to exchange his goods, exchange his wheat to shoe. Otherwise, both the shoemaker and the what is called that, the wheat producer cannot exchange it. Then both the persons have to search for the another person, another person who is accept their goods. Otherwise, both the persons cannot exchange their product. So this situation is called double coincidence of wants. Next important topic is limitations of barter system. The fourth topic that we are going to discuss is limitations or disadvantages. Limitations or disadvantages. Double coincidence of wants. Wants is the great disadvantage. A feature of the system that in the previous topic we discussed. So therefore this becomes a great obstacle or a great disadvantage of this system. All commodities, try to understand, all commodities or goods are not equal unit of value. So therefore it is difficult. It is difficult to exchange for how much for what. So here the all the commodities are not equal value of equal unit of value. For example, hundreds of bags of wheat and car rate is not same. Like that, hundreds of salt and 1 gram of gold is not same value. So each and every commodities and each and every products or goods or service are not a equal unit of value. So it is difficult, very difficult to calculate the total amount of cost of the product and services. Therefore, it is the second important disadvantage of this system. The system also lack in measure of value. The system has lack of measure of store of value. Barter system. Has no standard for future payment. Why here is even measure of store of value? There are goods which are perishable goods which cannot be stored for longer period. So if there is, if we store the such a goods, it will decay soon. Their quality will decrease. Therefore, we cannot sell the same cost when it was brought in the market. Like that, the barter system has no standard for future payment. This also we cannot use in this system. For example, the cost of 1 gram of gold rate is 10 years before, it was the rate is different. In the future or now, it is increased. And like that, any other product, any other the vegetables, fruits and vegetables, flowers, these perishable products, which is always in the seasonal time, it is either the rate of this product is based on demand and supply. Demand and supply is a major factor for the rate of any product. Suppose there is a high demand and the supply is low, automatically the price of the product will increase. If the demand is low but the supply is more, the product rate will go decrease. So the demand and demand and supply is a major factor for the price of the product. So therefore, these are the drawbacks or these are the disadvantages in the barter system. Next we are going to discuss deposits with the fourth topic is deposits with banks. This is fifth topic. A question will come, what is a bank? Bank is nothing but it is a financial institution or it is a organization which is monetized by the Reserve Bank of India. It is a financial institution for transaction of deposits and the people who need money as a loan. So these are the activities that we are going to discuss, how the banks are functioning in this topic. What is a bank? A bank is a financial institution of both government and private. SBI, that is State Bank of India, IOB, Indian Overseas Bank, then Indian Bank, Karnataka Bank, Canara Bank, etc. These are the banks of government sector bank or public government or public. Government of public sector banks, the KVB, Karur Vysya Bank, LVB, Lakshmi Vilas Bank, HDFC, Repco, Axis Bank, these are private sector bank. So the banks are divided into two based on their ownership, the SBI, IOB, Indian Bank, Karnataka Bank and Kerala Bank. These are the banks are government bank or public sector bank, Karur Vysya Bank, KVB, Karur Vysya Bank, Lakshmi Vilas Bank, HDFC Bank, Repco Bank, Axis Bank, these are the examples for private sector banks. Banks, the question arises, why people to deposit their money in the bank and how they deposit the money, that we are going to discuss now. Why do people deposit money? Deposits their money in the bank. Why do people deposit their money in the bank? For instance, a person he is earning through his economic activity this and at a times he do not want to say expense all the monies at a time, so he need only a little amount day to day expenditure for household things, purchasing of household things like groceries, vegetables, milk and other household commodities. He needs only some amount of money, and he also need some larger amount. This larger amount he will keep in savings. So this savings, if he keep in the home, it is not safe and secure. Also, there is no possibility of increasing the amount if the money is kept in his under his control or in his home. If suppose the person who deposits money in the bank, the money will give the some amount of money as interest. This interest money is always a gain for the depositor. Let us discuss now the top here, the points. For instance, thank you. for their household expenditures. Extra amount so now they have some extra amount some particular period of time so this extra money they are going to deposit in the bank. So the extra amount only they are going to spend, they are going to deposit in the banks. The banks accept, deposits and give some amount as interest on this account, on this deposits. Try to understand, the people earn some amount of money in their through their economic activities, and they spend some little amount of money for their day-to-day expenditure, and the remaining extra amount, if they keep in their hands, it will not increase. So if they deposit the extra amount in the bank accept the deposits and gives some amount of money as interest on these deposits. So now two ways the depositor get benefited. One way the money is safe, another way the money is getting some amount of money as interest. So in two ways they are getting benefited. The how the bank how to open an account or deposit in the banks. The bank is introduced for deposit schemes called that is a savings bank SD account, and there is another account is called current account, and the third deposit is called recurring deposit, that is RD, and the fourth one is fixed deposit FD. So these are the four banks provide SB account, current account, recurring deposit account, FD account, fixed deposit account. SBI account, savings account. So in this account, the, how to, first they want to, now there is two way that we can open a bank account. That is one way, visit the bank personally and they open a account in the bank. That is they give a form, account opening form. In that form, they want to fill their name, age of the date of birth, their father's name. Then they want to fill the data in which date it is opened and what type of account it is, whether it is a SBI account or current account or recurring deposit account or fixed deposit account, whatever the account they want to mention in the application form. And in that application form, they want to put signature. The signature, it should be, they ask to same signature, specimen signature copy, they will upload in the computer. So this is one way that people visit the bank and open the bank account. Another method is the people can open the account through the mobile phone or through the internet. That is, if you open the bank website, any bank, in which bank we want to open an account, that bank website we open, in that we click the option of opening bank account, then the details they will ask, the same details will ask, the name of the applicant, that is depositor, and date of birth, then what type of account. So everything if you fill in the on the website, then if you submit, then the account is opened. So this is the bank accept the public deposits account and maintain their account. They provide also, the bank also provide, whenever the people need to get the amount, it is demand, the SBI account. This is called a deposit, demand deposit. Why it is called demand deposit? If the people deposit their money in this account, whether it is a SBI account or a current account, the people can get, that means the people can withdraw their money at any time, any day, any time, they can withdraw money, therefore, on demand, because therefore, it is called a demand deposit. But in this recurring and FD, it is not possible, because the recurring deposit account, the people deposit the money every month, some 100 rupees or 200 rupees or 500 rupees or 1000 rupees, 2000 rupees, like this. If they deposit their money in this account, after 1 year or 2 years or 3 years or 5 years, any number of fixed number of years, if they every month they are depositing their money in this account, and finally they get with the lump sum of amount along with their deposited amount and interest, so both together they can collect it from the bank after the maturity is get over. Like that, the deposit, fixed deposit account also, we can deposit the money fixed number of years, the amount also fixed, the term of period also is fixed, therefore it is called fixed deposit. It may be the 5,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees or 50,000 rupees, 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 5 lakh, 20 lakhs, whatever the amount we have, we can deposit in this FD account for fixed number of years, 1 year, 2 year, 5 years, 10 years. So in this way they are depositing money, we will get along with the deposited money and extra amount as interest, so with both together we get, so our money is safer and also the people get interest. So by this way, people's money is safe with banks and it earns some amount of money as interest. So with this, the five topics we discussed so far in this video, I hope that you understand. Follow this, you will get a worksheet in this topic only. So you go through your book and study the lesson carefully, and wherever the doubt, you notice down and ask later on. Thank you.